Hello. I hope this video finds you doing well. I'm out here in the woodlands of Ridley Creek State Park, Pennsylvania. It is the end of January 2018, and it's about 40 degrees. It's a crisp, chilly 40 degrees, overcast. The sun's trying to come out, but it looks almost like as if it were going to rain or snow. But I don't think that's in the forecast, otherwise I wouldn't be out here. I hope your new year is off to a good start. Of course, there's always, you know, life is like the stock market. Life is like a cardiogram, you know. It shows the heartbeats. It's up and down. There's always, sometimes there's smooth sailing, sometimes there's rough seas. And we, you know, we make do the best we can through each moment. And I do want to apologize for any sounds of planes or vehicles passing. Just things that are beyond my control. But I wanted to come out here and share with you something that I think is as close to the objective truth that, you know, one can get, or that we can get. And that is, I believe, but I don't think it's a belief, but I'm going to say it's a belief because I don't want to come across as being arrogant enough to say that I know the truth, although still I will say that I believe this is the truth, that we should be living out here in nature, living off the land, perhaps as hunter-gatherers. I don't really know how, but what I feel strongly about and what I have strong convictions about is that we should be living out here in some form or fashion. Now, there's a couple things that probably come to mind when I say that. One of them probably is, yeah, you're kidding. If you want to, you know, go ahead, ER, Paul. If you want to live that way, go ahead. No. Good luck. I'm going to stay here in the comforts of modern society. And I am totally with you. I understand, you know, why you might say that. But I would still say that you've just been, and we, actually, all of us have been misled. We've been lied to into believing that modern society, civilization, is how we should be living. And I know you'll also say, well, Paul, ER, if you want to go ahead and live that way, go ahead. You know, let's see you back it up. You might call me a hypocrite. Well, I wasn't taught how to live out here. I was born into civilization. The whole purpose of this video, and I've kind of forgot to mention this at the very beginning, there's a couple purposes of this video. Number one, it's not to convince anyone to give up all your worldly possessions and go and live out in nature, because it's a death sentence for any of us dependent upon civilization to get up, leave everything behind, and to move out here when we don't have the knowledge how to survive. It's suicide. It's existential suicide, and it's realistic suicide. And I'll get into that existential bit, and which you may already know. The second thing is, the whole purpose of this video is to make this statement This is not going to change my videos. This is not going to, like, all of a sudden, you know, turn my channel into anything. This is just one side of me, an aspect of me that I feel strongly about, and I think I've come to the full realization. The other thing is, probably more importantly, the purpose of this video is that if you are struggling with these same thoughts and you have a yearning or you feel a calling to nature, then I want to let you know that you're not alone. It's not just, you know, I'm not the only one who thinks this way, and you're not either. There's plenty of folks who have left civilization, left society behind and gone out, some successful, some not so much. But I think, you know, so that's what this video is. It's not to convince you, not that I'm right, not that I have the truth, although I think it is the truth, the objective truth that we should be living out here. But it's to make this statement, and it's to reach anyone out there who feels the same. And somehow, some way, that together, you and I, and those out there, no, not watching this video, but of the same mindset, we can somehow navigate and live a calm, peaceful lifestyle in a system, in a society that is often anything but calm and peaceful. Now, when I say it's, you know, true freedom is a death sentence. What I mean by that is, this living out here off the land is true freedom. Becoming an independent artist, being a business owner, that's not true freedom. Being a millionaire, that's not true freedom. Being a wealthy YouTuber, I'm not a wealthy YouTuber, but, you know, someone with millions of subscribers is making six figures. They're wealthy. They're no longer one of us. Same with an actor or a musician. But they're not free. They're still dependent upon this system. A system where people are often making minimum wage, or people living in other countries making who knows what, often a meager existence, work for the companies that supply us the food. So you pick any famous person, any celebrity, making all those millions, but they're still dependent upon society to provide them their food and their shelter and their clothing. So they're not free. They're still as much dependent as the poor person. Okay. This is total freedom. And that's when I say that leaving everything behind, and to obtain true freedom, true ultimate freedom, living off the land, existing out in nature, is a death sentence. It's in two ways. It's an existential death sentence, because you are leaving behind everything you've been taught, everything that you've been taught to believe is true, and how you should be living your life, that you should be working, becoming a productive member of society. It's just slavery when you get down to it. I know that sounds like an exaggeration. I know that sounds like an extreme form of talking, but it is. In order for you to get food in civilization, in society, you have to work for someone. Work for a company, or you work for, like, YouTubers. You work for the general public and for advertising, like actors. Actors, you know. So you're not free. You have to pay. And where do you get the money? So it's an existential, you know, true freedom coming out here, living out here as we were designed to live, which I'll get to in a moment, is a death sentence, an existential death sentence. It doesn't mean, when I say a death sentence, it doesn't mean that you can't, but for most of us, we would probably be dead in a week. We don't have the tools or the knowledge how to live out here and exist out here, which I'll get to as well. So just the thought of this is how we should live is an existential death sentence, because you're basically saying that everything you have been taught and everything that we have been taught is not the truth. And the truth is that we should be living out here, but we're not prepared to live out here. And when you reach that conclusion, like I have, it can be very depressing. And that's why I say like a existential suicide. Because it's like, wow, this is reality, but I don't know how to live out here, but so I have to go back to civilization and work for someone, do something that it's not fulfilling, make money, gather material possessions, but that's not satisfying. Why? Well, and I'll get into that as well. Because you're not reaping the rewards, pretty much. You're not doing what you were meant to do as a human being. Now, it's also a realistic or physical death sentence, aside from a existential one, because, again, you don't have the knowledge or know-how. Most of us living in society can't just leave our homes in the suburbs or the city, our apartments, our flats, and come out here and all of a sudden, the next day, know how to hunt, know how to gather, know how to keep from freezing, know how to make our own clothing, know how to make the tools for hunting. I mean, I'm talking giving up all modern conveniences. Leave the fishing pole behind, leave the gun behind, and come out here and live a primitive lifestyle, which is how I believe we should be living. Again, I'm not out here to say that we should all must do it now. Okay, that's kind of opinion, that's kind of subjective. I'm just saying we should be living out here. Cut and dry, right to the point. And you can see that by people who go fishing, they go hunting. They're trying to tap in to our human nature. That's what we were designed to do. And I'll talk about that now, being designed to live in nature. The reason you have legs and arms is because nature designed you that way over the course of millions of years. I don't know how long our species has been around. 5 million years is the approximation, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. Now, when I say designed, it could be a god, or it could be just random chance, evolution. Which is what I believe. I don't think there is a god. And I think, we just got lucky that there's a sun and a moon and this planet and everything kind of aligned just right to make the perfect soup, to make the perfect stew for life on this planet. However many millions of years ago when we first crawled out of the primordial stew. And, we diverged from some ape. There's experts on that. And I'm not really here to give a history lesson. Okay, you can do all your research. But we were designed. The reason we have legs is not to work, to stand on them for 8 hours at a cash register. Working for someone else, being the backbone of a company. so that the people at top, the executives, can reap all the rewards. It's not to work construction 8 hours a day. It's not to be a nurse 8 hours a day or 10 hours a day on our feet. It's to navigate our environment, to walk around, to climb, to run in the face of danger, to use our legs to propel ourselves across the landscape to find food, to use these things to get the food, whether it's an animal that we have to kill or berries, fruit, vegetables, to fish, whatever part of the land that you live near, that you live off of. These weren't designed to sit, to be typing in a computer 8 hours a day while you develop carpal tunnel syndrome. These were used, or were designed by evolution over the millions of years to, I think more recently, the latter part of our evolution, to create tools so that we could adapt and survive better on the planet. We were born from this planet. Now, I know that there's going to be people, maybe think I'm a little crazy. I mean, if you haven't thought I'm a little touched already based on some of the videos that I make, but believe me, I have my feet firmly planted in reality, okay? All right, I'm not about to leave my wife and son behind and abandon them and watch them struggle, on one income and, have to all this so that I can come out here and say, I found the truth and I'm going to live in nature and no. But back to what I was saying about how we were designed. So we were designed through evolution, which I believe is probably the truth, that no God. Now, I will say this about the possibility of a God, that it is kind of odd. And this is the very, very, very 0.00001% of credence that I will give that there may be a God that designed all this. Because even if it's just an accident, and I don't mean a God meaning nature, the power of nature, I mean a God like a sentient being, an all-powerful sentient being, that kind of God. It's kind of interesting how of all the planets in the solar system and everything in it, that Earth is the only place that has life on it, right? Now, I know we can, there's a lot to that. The universe has been around for millions of years. The universe is infinitely expansive beyond our knowledge. So that it, having just, our universe could just fit on the tip of a pinky when the entirety of the universe is like our full body. Just to, So, but it's still a little interesting. And I was thinking about that just a day before making this video. That how of the entirety of the universe that we know of, only life on this planet. Isn't that kind of interesting? Kind of, it's like almost too, with all things, with the universe being random and all of that, that everything just aligned just right so that this planet, of all the planets that we've discovered thus far, is the only one that has life on it. So I'll just give a little bit of credence to the fact that maybe there's something out there. But it's not a Jesus. It's not an Allah. I don't know what. Maybe it's just the luck of the dice. But I don't want to get into a thing about how life got started here. However it got started, we were designed through the course of evolution into the form that you see today. We are an animal. We're part of the animal kingdom, okay? Although in today's world, it seems like we are more than an animal, like we're beyond, like we're our own little species. And that's just because of the illusion of society and civilization that we're like somehow we're advanced. But we're not. We may be advanced technologically, but we are not advanced when it comes to human behavior. And I don't need to remind you, but I will, of all the horrible things that happen in the world. From simple things, well, they're not simple, but from the less horrible, like bullying and stealing, you know, and thieves, to the more horrible things like terrorism. That's because we're still an animal. We haven't changed. What's changed is all the external stuff, the tools that we use, the structures that we build. That hasn't changed what's inside. So we were designed to use our legs to navigate and to live out here, to hunt and to forage. And I believe that we should return to being hunters and gatherers. That's my, right now, through my 45 some years of existence as a human being, from being on the inside of being raised Catholic, Christian, being Roman Catholic, being inside that system for 18 years of my life, from being inside civilization for 40 some years of my life. I have observed, I have analyzed, and I have come to the conclusion right now, the full realization personally, that this is probably where we belong. And that civilization, you know, with the advent, with the dawn of civilization, it's a female mallard flying by. With the dawn of civilization, with the advent of agriculture, that's when we traded our humanity. What makes us human, hunting and gathering, the knowledge of tools, the knowledge how to do those things, being together, being communal, being social, supporting one another, living as tight, strong bond, family bonds together, where we share knowledge and we share stories, and we hunt and gather together, and we're doing things together. We are living together as a family and with other families. And there's a lot of social activity, and we watch for each other. We're very neighborly. That has been splintered and broken apart because of the pressures and strains of civilization. Now, so I'm going to get into that, all that here, but I kind of wanted to start all this, you know, this little, the beginning of this video here. It's not so much the beginning anymore. You know, but this is why you look like, if you were meant to be at a keyboard all day, then your body wouldn't develop carpal tunnel syndrome. And your hands might always be in this position. If you were designed to be on your feet all day, you know, you wouldn't get Charlie horses or, you know, whatever else, you know, bad back problems. If we were designed to sit all day, our bodies would be designed differently, with a spine that probably looks like this, and our legs would always be like this instead of upright. You know, you would walk around like this if we were designed to sit on a chair all day. But we weren't. So, and I know that it's difficult, and maybe you might be obstinate or stubborn to want to accept that this might be the possibility, because it is very, and I can understand that, because it's saying that everything you've been taught, everything that we've been led to believe is civilization, is modern, is advanced, is a lie. It's really just to benefit people at the top of the food chain, the system of hierarchy. I can never say that word right. So, We were designed to live out here. And I'm pretty sure that is the truth, the subjective truth. All my life, I have been drawn to nature, and I didn't know why until now. When I was a kid, I was outside riding my bike, walking through the woods, swinging from a rope tied to a tree, you know, jumping into the water, climbing trees and jumping out of trees. I'd climb up two stories and jump out of a tree, and I fractured my arm or my wrist doing that once. I was like a monkey. I was like a person that would live a primitive, you know, I'm a primitive creature. That hasn't changed. But I have been trained like a circus monkey to do what civilization expects from me and what society expects from me, to be a productive member of society, a responsible member of society, and all that, all those terms that are, those fancy, those big words that all the executives use and the business leaders use to make them sound important, because that is the terminology that business people use to sound important so that they can keep up the appearance and that they keep their jobs. That's what they're doing. I've been in those circles. I've worked McDonald's. I was a cook. I've worked retail. I've stocked shelves. I've worked behind a desk, worked in the office with copying machines. I've been around people that love to gossip. I've been around executives. I've been around, you know, all that. And yet, none of it has ever made me happy. I mean, think about it. If civilization and modern society brought us happiness, why would I even be out here making this video? You know? A video that's not going to make me a lot of money, just like most of my nature videos, which I don't really do to make money so much. It's to help me survive. I mean, I have a car that's paid off. I have a home. I have video games. I have a computer. Why would I be making a video like this? I should be, you know, sitting back on my laurels, enjoying just getting lost in the video games. Because it's not fulfilling. Why? Because it's placating. It's my existence. It's pandering. It's numbing. It's sedating me. It's an escape. It's a drug. Entertainment is a drug. You know how they say religion is an opium for the masses? Well, so is entertainment. YouTube, movies, Netflix, video games, it's a drug. And they're just keeping us sedated and asleep, numbing the pain. Numbing the pain of society and civilization and all of its stresses. So, let's get into that. But real quick, we were designed, let me just end with the whole being designed out here, being designed to live out here. It would cure obesity. How often do you see obese, indigenous, or aboriginal, primitive people? I don't think it's, if at all, probably very rare. Why? Because they're using their bodies the way they were meant to be used, to be active. And they hunt and they forage for what they need. They're not obtaining excessive amounts of anything. They have enough to, you know, to store and all this. Well, I'm not an expert on primitive societies, okay? And none of us are. That's another thing I want to say. You can be as learned and as scholarly as possible about primitive societies and Aboriginal cultures, but you have never lived it and experienced it firsthand. So you can't say, now as much as I can say, I'm saying that we're meant to live out here because that's where we were designed. I'm trying to be objective. I'm not saying how, but that we should be living out here. But I can't say that living a primitive lifestyle is any better or any worse, or any more stressful or any less stressful. All I'm trying to say is this is where we belong. How we go about living out here, I don't know. Because why? Because I only know how society and civilization raised me. Raised me for the first 18 years of my life and yours until adulthood, until independence, or at least so-called independence, when you live on your own, although you're still not totally free, you're just free from adults telling you how to live your life. Now you can live your life, but you're still living a life of servitude. So for the first 18 years of our lives, or before we live on our own, everything is handed to us. Everything is done for us. The majority of modern humans. We don't know how to fend for ourselves. Oh, so you know how to fish. Okay, great. You really think that you're going to be able to survive out here because you know how to fish or hunt? What about preparing and cooking it and storing it, or maintaining your tools, or maintaining a shelter or creating a shelter? You don't know how to... We partake in these little things, you know, fishing and hunting, because it calls to who we are as human beings, the hunter and the gatherer. It's how we should be living. So those are simple ways to try to get in touch with who we are, but yet at the end of the day we still resort going back to our civilization, to our homes, to our jobs. When we should really be fishing however often throughout the day to get our food, then to go back as a family unit, and then we go back to our families and we live wherever we live out here, and we share in the joy in the fruits of our labor. You know, which is kind of what I want to get to. There's a lot of different aspects of this. This is not just a real cut and dry thing. I'm trying to think this out as much as I could, as much as I can, right now, at this juncture. So, and that's what living a primitive, yes, there are pros and cons to a primitive lifestyle, to the hunter and gatherer, as much as there are pros and cons to living civilized, and I want to get into those as well. Believe me, this is not just, hey everybody, let's just come out, live in nature, it's wonderful, it's peaceful, we can just kumbaya, and we'll go kill some deer, and everything's going to be wonderful. No, life is not meant to be easy in primitive life or civilization. Human behavior hasn't changed. Life, nature itself, has no conscience, doesn't care, it's going to throw, you've seen it. You live in a primitive society, where you live in civilization. Nature's going to throw a tornado at you, a tsunami. Trees are going to fall, destroy your house, or destroy your primitive hut. You know, there's going to be floods. You know, just acts of nature that are going to... That's not going to change. So I think I spoke enough about that we were designed to live out here. That's why we have legs and arms. Legs to get us to where we need to propel ourselves across the landscape, and the arms to hunt and gather, to kill, and to come with the realization and the acceptance that you have to kill to survive. So it's not like, oh my God, we shouldn't kill animals. No, that's what you're meant to do. So that we could feed this hole, which is the only way Right? We have no built-in instructions. There's no computer that's telling us, okay, go out and go find a squirrel and kill a squirrel. I must eat squirrel and I must eat raisins. No, there's not. We don't have any. That's the one of the flaws of being human, or in any animal, at least being human, is having all this free will. Yet we don't even know what we're supposed to eat. You look at most other animals, and the snake, it goes after anything, it uses its tongue to sense anything that's warm-blooded. Apes, gorillas, they just eat, you know, whatever, plants and all that. You know, they're not sitting there thinking, oh, should I eat this? How should I, you know, what am I supposed to eat? Oh, I shouldn't eat. They're not having all these thoughts. And then there's us. And I don't know if human beings are like, you know, nature gone wrong, you know? But really, we don't even know, like, what to do with ourselves and what to eat anymore. It's all, and everything, and when I think about civilization and how we live today, think about everything, this isn't a guilt trip, but think about everything that our species has fought and struggled for, so that we could sit on our laurels and play video games. Everything that has been taught through the generations prior to civilization is lost. I mean, yeah, you can, I mean, it's still, the knowledge is out there. How to hunt and how to fish, okay? With a rifle, with a fishing pole. Okay, so there are advanced forms of technology, advanced tools. But most of us, we're not taught that in school. That's one of the problems with civilization. It's not teaching us how to be human. Teaching us how to be cogs in the machine. Teaching us how to work for someone. How to math, how to English, how to history. I don't really care about George Washington. I don't really care about the Romans and the Roman aqueducts. I don't really care about why this so-and-so president did such and such. It's not important. What's important is teach me how to be a human being and how to live out here. But we don't do that because that's been taken away from us. All the food is now controlled by, you know, the farming, the people, the companies, the farming companies, all the industrialized farming when it comes to the cows and the chickens and the pigs, you know, local farmers and things like that. So that's done for us already. The hunting and gathering is already done for us. So now what do? Okay, we don't hunt and gather. Okay, so now what? Well, I still need food, but these people own the food and have to pay for the food. Okay, so this person has the food, and I can go work for that person. Hopefully they'll give me a percentage of what they earn so that I can buy the food that they control. Or I can go work for this person or these people over here and whatever the hell they're doing, you know, in society, making cakes or creating cars or making video games so that I can get a percentage of them, so I can take that money and go over here and pay the guy who owns the food, and then that's how I survive. So I want to kind of get into that a little bit. So we've traded our humanity for slavery. That's pretty much what it is. We're no longer free. We're no longer independent, having the amount of knowledge to live out here. Now, there is a truth, or there is an aspect of living out here, which is, hunting and gathering. It's more than just that. There are the elements, the harsh, often elements, right? Right, so you give up your comfort. So I guess we can get into some of that. That it's more than just the lure and attraction of living out here in nature where it's all so peaceful and wonderful and quiet. No, there is a harsh aspect of living out here, I'm sure. However, You and I don't know that. How harsh is it? How worse off is living a primitive lifestyle compared to civilization? I don't know. You don't know. We can study and learn, but we haven't lived it. It's not like you can come to me and say, Ephemeral Rift, you're wrong. We shouldn't live out here because I've lived in a primitive society for 20 years of my life. If I could sit down, and a primitive person can't say, we can't live a civilized life because blah, 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 blah. So you have to have knowledge of both systems. And I don't think you can find someone. Unless you find, because even if I was to live civilization and learn how to be primitive, I wasn't born and raised in a primitive lifestyle. So I can't say, yes, this is how we should truly live. I believe, I'm only saying that we should truly live out here because this is how we were designed. We're animals. Nature designed us to live out here. We come from here. A God didn't create us 2,000 years ago or anything like that. Or however many, whatever date and time or point in time that a lot of religious people feel that we believe that we've only been around. It took millions of years for us to get here. And we're just throwing it all away, all that knowledge, so that we can work for someone and buy some video games and we escape the truth, the reality of civilization. That it's broken, that puts too much stress on us. It's depressing, we're unhappy. Because, and that's, so let's kind of get into all that, I guess, the pros and cons. So the first thing is, I guess, the giving up the comforts, right, of modern civilization and living out in the harsh environment of primitive lifestyle. Okay, so those comforts, those come with price. What's the price? Stress. What's stress? Stress of getting a job, whatever job, and paying bills, making sure your bills are paid so you don't go into debt, so you don't have problems with creditors, and on all of those implications, working whatever job, and not being, and when it comes to that job, it's doing whatever you're told. And dealing with all those implications of having a job. You're going to do what you're told, no matter whether you agree with it or not, even if it goes against your personal beliefs and philosophy. Work whatever hours you're told to work. Mandatory overtime. Get paid a little bit compared to the people at the top. And all that. So it's not just like, oh, I have a home and this is it. It's really easy. No. Because your home could be taken away from you if you don't maintain all those financial obligations. So you're not really free. So yeah, you have the comfort of a home, right? You've traded the risk and the harshness of living in the natural world and the environment for a more comfortable, safer one. But there's a lot of strings attached to that. Just like I mentioned, and probably even some more. Now, what about things like, all right, so food. So we give up working for someone, stop being a slave, and you come out here to live with your family as a tribe, how I believe we should all live, social creatures, where we are raised naturally, and we are strong family bonds, generations of families living together, interacting with other tribes, being social, not being torn apart by civilization, where we just dump our family members off into a nursing home when they get older. Because why? Because we have to work, we're pressured into working, and we don't have the knowledge of how to take care of someone that's older. Again, we lack the knowledge how to be human. We lack the knowledge of how to be human to survive out here, and we lack the knowledge on how to be human. We have no humanity when it comes to taking care of each other. Now we throw away our one another and let someone else take care of it. What is that? That's not civilized. So, digress there a little bit. If we were living, that's what society does to us, though. That's what civilization has done. That's what the cancer, the parasite of civilization has done to us. It is causing so much stress on us as families. We don't even see each other. We should be together all day long, living out here as family members, as human beings, as familial organisms. You know, as little tribes. And I'm trying to think this from a very objective mindset. So you're not living in a separate room. Away from, you know, parents don't live in one room and you live in another room where you're raised in a crib. That's why, you know, we've practiced our family at some primitive-like aspects, co-sleeping. We have, at some point in time, all slept in the same bed together. And that's how I believe that families should be living. But instead, what do? The husband and wife sleeps in the bed, and the kid sleeps over here in another room. And you want to know why there's anxiety issues? You want to know why the kid wets the bed? You want to know why they have mommy and daddy issues? That's not how you live, separated like that. Now, that's not necessarily, that's civilization, that's society. Society says that, that's the norm. See, that's another problem with society and civilization. Somewhere this norm came up that you live separately. You should be living together in this, you know, going to sleep together in the same little room, like you would out here, under the same little hut. Maybe not right on next to each other, but, you know, spread out, but you're still right there. So that your child knows you're right there. You know, they're not in a separate room all by themselves. You know? We're not, you know, human beings are not like any other animal where, you know, we're a higher species, where our young should be with us. We're not like snakes. You know, as soon as a snake hatches, or as soon as any other lesser species of animal is born, it becomes independent within a matter of months or days, right? Days. Right. So we should all be living together out here as a strong family unit, you know? And then there's other family units that we come to know, and we're very social, and we help each other, and we share all the knowledge of hunting and foraging and all that, and we work together to survive. Now, it's very idealistic, I know. And I know that there are other cultures out there, primitive tribes, aboriginal, indigenous, all that, that have had their problems, okay? That's human behavior. Human behavior is not going to change and hasn't changed, whether we're primitive or civilized. So, living out here, coming to live out here as a primitive species, returning to how we should live, is not going to cure human behavior. But this is where we belong. The human behavior, that animal, that the greed, the need to survive, that's not going to change no matter what you, where you place us. Look at civilization. You know, the terrorism. Look at politics, political corruption. Look at people being placed in jail for crimes they haven't committed. Look at the racial, the number of, I guess, African Americans or Black Americans here in the United States that are in the, you know, charged of crimes for owning cannabis, a plant that grows freely on the, you know, that we've called it illegal, and the drug war and the war against drugs and all that. you could still have those problems living out here in a primitive lifestyle. Let's take a look at, so let's go back to the food. Talk about the food. So in a civilization, to get the food that is controlled by a few people, right? Because you're not going out there and even if you hunt a deer, you're not doing that all year long. Unless you are someone that lives on the very edge of civilization. But for most of us, we're going to the supermarket, the grocery store, or whatever you want to call it, to get the food that has already been hunted and gathered for us. But it's not really, they are hunters. They're a hunter. They're not hunters and gatherers. They have cattle in a big old, on a giant piece of land that just gets slaughtered every day. It's not hunting and gathering. It's manufactured food. That's what it is. Which is something that I don't agree with. Animals should be left to just roam. They shouldn't be pets. They shouldn't be in these, you know, industrialized farms, penned up. They should be living out there until we need to go out and kill them to survive. Just like an animal, any other animal would kill us to survive. So there's no difference there. Okay? We're all animals trying to survive. But how this animal goes about its business is all wrong. It's not natural. So the food, you come out here and you work for your food. And in return, something I forgot at the very beginning is to say that living out here, our entire mind and body would be one, in focus, in line. Not our minds over here focusing on how to make money or entertainment, and our bodies are being pulled in this way and we're being pulled apart. Out here, your mind and your body are one. You're in line, a total, complete human alignment. Because you live out here, this is where you find your food. You hunt and gather your food, and you see it all happening right before you. You are the beginning and the end to the means of survival. You are reaping what you sow. You are getting all the rewards, and those of your tribe. You're all working together. Maybe you have, and when it comes to someone that has a disability, learning disability or a physical handicap, they can't hunt and gather. Well, you love each other. They're part of your family. And you take care of them. And other people help to chip in. Maybe other families that you've come to know. And you're all living together. And now I know it's like an ideal and utopian way of thinking. You're going to have people out here, probably, they're going to want to steal from you. Well, guess what? You have people stealing in modern civilization from each other. That's human behavior. That's not going to get cured. Okay? That's that very primitive need for survival, and that when you are forced, when your hand is forced to get food to survive, you will do whatever it takes to survive. And that includes stealing from someone so that you can get that money to buy more drugs, because the drugs, you're so angry with civilization and fed up that you just, you know. Heroin is no different than video games. In so much, I'm not talking about the physical, but just the drugs. The entertainment, we're worshiping entertainment, entertainers now more than ever. It just shows you how unhappy we are with our lives. How we're not fulfilled. That we need others to make us happy. Why? Because we're not living out here, living fulfilling, meaningful lives. Civilization is causing the family to splinter. So, but let's get back to those pros and cons. I know there's so many things to think about. You can't get done in the video. You need to write a book about it. And I'm sure there have been books written about it. And I would love to come out here. Believe me, I wish I had the knowledge to teach. No, and my wife had the knowledge, and we could teach our son, we'd come out here and we could survive and be happy living out here. And I could teach my son, how to fish. I mean, he knows how to fish. Yeah. But what's the point? What's the point of fishing? There's fish at the supermarket. I could go out here and fish. I don't even know what kind of, how healthy the water is, or the fish are. That's another problem. So I gotta go to the supermarket because at least I know it's a little bit more healthier, the fish there, than it is swimming in the Schuylkill River. And those of you not familiar with the Philadelphia, Pennsylvania region, the Schuylkill River is just a very polluted, dirty river that runs through the city or near the city. Well, I mean, I don't really know how dirty it is, but it's, you know, it's a city that runs near the, it's a river that runs near the city, and we all know about pollution and all that. So civilization, when it comes to food, civilization will, you're going to be stressed out, and you're going to find the food until you gain enough money where you have lots of money that you're a little less stressed out because of whatever you're doing, but you're still you're getting food that other, you're now, you're still dependent upon other people, though. You're dependent upon the person that works slaughtering the cows. So you sit back with all your wealth and you have it easy, but you're dependent upon the people that work in the slaughterhouse, or the people that work in China putting together the clothes that you wear, or help make the TV, or the packaging for the video games, or the disc, or whatever, or your cell phone. That's the other problem, the aspect of society. I can't avoid going down all these divergent paths. One of the biggest problems that we probably don't even aware of on a day-to-day basis in modern society is this global economy, where we enable, by participating, whether it's one penny or a dollar, or even if you don't work and you receive something created by civilization and this global economy, a product, a video game, your parents buy you a video game, we are supporting and enabling everyone, including the KKK, ISIS, whatever kind of the mafia. We are. Because it's a global economy. Let me explain. By spending, like, that $1 that we spend, that 1 cent that you spend and earn, could have made its way through contributions, campaign contributions to Donald Trump. It could have been a penny that was spent by the KKK, or a serial killer, or ISIS. And that's the other problem with being a member of this modern society, is not just the comforts and conveniences, is that we're all complicit in supporting and enabling everyone, a part of modern civilization, that can access this global economy. When ISIS, do you think ISIS makes their own clothes, or is part of their own little closed-off circuit from the rest of the world, and they manufacture their own weapons and their own little balaclavas and their own and all this? No. They are part of this economy. Even though they're way off another part of the world, the United States exchanges money with every other country. So we're all connected financially. So you go to buy a video game. Innocent, right? You support the company and the developers. That's pretty much what you think of. Maybe the voice actors. Well, there's a lot of that money goes to them, right? It goes to all those different people. And then what do? In turn, they spend it. So the money is constantly flowing throughout the world and exchanging hands. And it is that video game that you buy, somehow a member of the KKK could have been working for that company. Or maybe a member of the KKK or ISIS works for a company, or works somehow, or a member of the mafia, or any kind of gang, right? So you see this global economy, this civilized global economy that we are part of? Everyone. We're all supporting, you don't even know who. And that's one of the aspects of returning to this primitive lifestyle, is that you know who you're supporting when you hunt and gather. You have your tribe, and the other tribes that you maybe exchange with. And you're not earning money, blood money. I mean, that's what it is. Think about it. There's all these aspects of our lives that happen every day by participating in by living in the civilization, and by living in this global economy, which is attached, you know, they're kind of one and the same, you know, civilization and global economy. So every time I participate, every time I go to the supermarket and buy something, and I'm exchanging that money, or even give our son something, even though he's not participating directly, he's receiving the goods generated by society and this global economy. So we're all complicit. You might hate or dislike a certain aspect of society, like the KKK or ISIS, or maybe you're a Democrat and you don't like Republicans, or maybe you're a Tea Partier or this or whatever. Right? You can't stand these type of people, and you can't stand this and this. But guess what? You're enabling and supporting them by participating in this, in today's economy, in today's society. So the only way to stop supporting all these people who we don't know who we're supporting is to leave civilization and to come live out here. And at least while you may be exchanging with other tribes, and you don't really know if those tribes are exchanging with other tribes, and you could still, you know, supporting thieves or murderers among those tribes. It's hard to get away from that, no matter whether it's living a primitive lifestyle or in modern civilization. But at least you have the power to not, if you're sufficient and you and your family and maybe another tribe that you know doesn't have any murderers or thieves a part of it, and you're out here, living out here, surviving out here, at least you know where everything is going and who you're supporting. It's not like today's society where you go, where you earn a dollar, where you pay someone a dollar, and where does it go? Who's the support? It supports everyone. So that's the other aspect. And I want to do a video on that, because that's to map all that out. How this global economy supports everyone. People that you don't even agree with. Things that you don't like. Maybe you don't like how the fact that, you know, you could talk all day long, like these people on Twitter, all these celebrities that talk about Donald Trump is terrible. But they talk out of one mouth, they say that, but then their actions, by participating in this civilization and participating in this global economy, they're supporting Donald Trump. So you see, there is the contradiction. And there's lots of contradictions like that in this society with this global economy, with modern civilization. But aside from that, back to the pros and cons. So we already talked about the food, right? You have to, out here, you live off the land, you gotta survive. You gotta get your food every day. I don't know about the storage, how you store food or anything like that. All right, so, but finding the food and obtaining the food is the struggle any more or any less? Primitive versus civilization? Well, civilization, you still have people that will rob you. You're still dependent on getting money and getting a job so you can get the food, right? And having a place to store your food, so you need electricity, so you gotta pay your electric bill, you gotta have a place to live, to have your refrigerator, so you gotta pay rent, or for your house, you gotta pay a mortgage, right? So there's a lot of those financial aspects, all those pressures, okay? Now, living out here, there's the pressure of finding the food. Is there gonna be food to find? You know, is there gonna be fish? How far do you have to go? Where do you live? So there's those implications as well. So I don't know what the trade-off is psychologically. when it comes to depression. Okay? But, all right, so that's the food aspect. All right, what about the elements, living in the elements? Well, it's going to be a little bit rougher living out here, definitely. But I think you learn how to adapt and survive, so you move to a warmer climate. Well, you can't really today move to as a primitive person living in the warmer climates, because the warmer climates have now been replaced by cities and office buildings and apartment buildings and factories. So all the really nice places to live, you can't live because government says that they own the land or people own the land. So if you want to go live in some warm climate in the United States or wherever the heck you want to live, most likely someone owns the land, and that's another problem with civilization, land ownership. How do you own land? You own land through threats of force. That's how you own it. Get off my land or I'm going to shoot you, or I'm going to get the government to back me up because I'm a taxpayer. This land belongs to everyone. It doesn't belong to no one. It doesn't belong to anyone. It belongs to everyone, to all of life. We come from this. No one owns it. We didn't make the earth. Land ownership, the whole idea of land ownership, you know? That's another problem with civilization. But you come out here, you live out here, it's more the pros and cons. Keeping your food, having animals eat your food living out here. Now, I don't know how people living in a primitive lifestyle, Aboriginal people, Native Americans, you know, how they store their food to keep it away from predators and the like. You know, bears, wolves, squirrels, or even mice, rats, rodents, chipmunks. I don't know how they store food or if they even store their food. They live every day just hunting and gathering and eating, and that's it for the day. And same thing next day. That's the kind of lifestyle I would prefer to live. And we kind of live that way, our family. We go to the supermarket every day. We don't go and get a week's worth of food because I don't know if we're going to be hungry for what we bought today, 3 days from now. So we'll get a couple days worth of food sometimes, but not really anymore. So we hunt and gather on a daily basis at the supermarket. And that's not really hunting and gathering, but we minimalized. We're trying to live as natural as possible in this unnatural world. But getting back to the food, so you have food issues in civilization with roaches and mice. You have to be careful where you live. You know, you have those ants. So you still gotta put your food safely in storage. You're not all of a sudden, you know, there's plenty of, you know, we have exterminators. What about predators? Living out here, there's predators. Well, there's predators in modern civilization, too. People that want to take advantage of you financially. People that are going to break into your house, break into your apartment. You know, people that are going to want, you know, the solicitors that come in your house and want you to buy something. There's those types of predators. And there are still predators in the world, although civilization has pretty much destroyed a lot of the land and forced all those predators either to extinction or off into the mountains. But if you go hunting, you know, you gotta be careful of bears and maybe mountain lion, what have you. So the predators still exist. Now, living a primitive lifestyle, but if you were to live out here in groups and tribes, you would have more numbers. So if a bear was coming, you would probably have, you know, groups, numbers on your side to chase the bear away. Okay? Otherwise, if living out here was that bad and that horrible, there would be no primitive tribes today. But there are people living today, uncontacted tribes in the Amazon jungles. And if predators were that bad, there wouldn't be anybody living in the Amazon jungle. So it can't be that bad. Now, I don't want to get into the whole thing about when you look at those primitive people, how they live and their customs, and they got the, you know, bones through their noses and other things going on. That stuff, that's tertiary. That's no different than how we should live here. Should I wear a hat, my glasses, and all that stuff? I mean, you could, you know, those things that, is the fact that they're living out there how we should live, and I envy those people. So there's a safety factor, you know? Predators, you have, you know, if you live out here a primitive lifestyle, you might have another tribe want to kill you or do something worse to you or steal from you. You still have that in modern civilization. That's human behavior. Like I said, that's not going to change. So what about one of the major things that a lot of us deal with throughout our lives, whether it's genetic or whether it's attributed to society, and that is depression. Now, I believe coming out here, living a more simpler life, more life where you're in control, you have the knowledge, you're in control of your own life, you reap what you sow, you see, you know, you go, you hunt and forage, and you're seeing the rewards of your investment, the return, the immediate return, just like when you play a video game, and you get all those achievements, and you get those immediate gratification, that's replacing what we should be doing out here. You go out, you have the knowledge to hunt and fish, you go out, you catch a fish or some fish, get to feed yourself, your family, and you relish in that. Where you take down a deer and you live off of everything the deer has to provide and how long that food will last. But instead, that's all been replaced by entertainment now. The immediate return of the how entertainment placates us or panders to us, and the frustrations that we deal with in society. That's the trade-off, but it's an abnormal trade-off. But depression. I don't know if living out here and living in the harshness of the world is any much more depressing or less depressing a cause of than modern civilization. I don't know. I've never lived out here. None of us have. And the only way to find that out is to take someone that's lived in here, put them out, now take a lot of people, make them live out here in the wilds of the earth for 20, 30 years, and then find out. But see, you can't really do that, because for the first 20, 30 years of our lives, of civilized life, and then to go out into the live primitively is such a drastic change, and you weren't born in. If you could be born into both, if you could be born, you know, born in the primitive lifestyle, and then be born into civilization from the beginning, you know, like born again, honestly, from a childhood. If you could actually live two lives, and then at the end and sit back, and then you'll be able to make a judgment as to whether which one was better or worse. So I can't answer that. Well, we can do some studies on people that live, live primitive lifestyles, but you can't really get inside their heads, you know? And you can't really get inside their heads and then compare that to people living a primitive lifestyle. So it's really difficult to truly make an objective statement about whether depression will be any worse or any more alleviated living a primitive lifestyle. I would like to think it will be more alleviated, less depression. While there is still the pressure and stress to find food, depending on where you live, I don't really know how much food is abundant, but there are lots of, depending on where you live, there's plenty of fish. You know, if you live near the salmon streams, where the bears, all the nature documentaries, all the bears, you always see them, you know, you have to compete with the bears to get some of the salmon, but there's plenty of salmon in those streams, and you could live off of fish most of your life and hunt bear, you know. Have the knowledge to do that and wear the bear skin, keep warm, however all that works. Okay. Now I'm trying to cover as many angles and aspects of reverting to a primitive lifestyle that I can, than I can think of. Because I don't want to just come out here and say, I love it out here. This is where we belong because it's nice and peaceful and we can fish. There's a lot more to it than that. But I think our minds and bodies would be one in alignment, doing the things that you're meant to do as a human being. Go out and hunting and fishing, you're in control of your own life, you're in control of the food that you get, you know what you're eating. Building your own structures, you're in charge of control of that with your own little group, your family group. Now when it comes to things like medicine, someone gets, you come out here and you get a broken leg, what do you do? I don't have an answer for that. I don't know what indigenous tribes or primitive tribes do in that case. I don't. But 5 million years, our species has lived out here. So it's not the be-all and end-all. Things are going to happen. There's no guarantees in life. But this living out here is natural. And somehow, and I'm going to have to bring this video to an end. I could probably go on and on with so many different angles and aspects. But I have been drawn to nature all my life. Like I said, and you've seen the nature videos that I do. And there is a peace. There is a very healthy effect when I come out here. Now, I don't know how to make use of living out here. That's the tragedy of it. I come out here and this is what I want. And this is what I think that we all need. But it's going to have to be a gradual change. And there are little things that we can do. We have to get away from government, society, the global economy where we support people that we don't even know. We have to get away from all that and come out here, but it's going to be gradual. You can't just do it overnight. And I don't know how we're going to do it. But you can just see the effects of civilization. All the isolation, how it's destroying the families. All the unhappiness, all the suicides. There shouldn't be suicide. Robin Williams, one of the most happiest people that I thought ever existed on the planet. I had no idea he was suffering as much as he was, or that he might have been bipolar, or he was bipolar. And of course, the issue with alcoholism, which is another thing of civilization. And he committed suicide. I don't know, does any other animal commit suicide? I don't think so. I've never seen, an ape or any other kind of creature kill itself. I don't know, maybe it happens, but it has to be a very rare occasion. And that's another thing that I think, now do primitive people commit suicide? Perhaps. I don't know what the mentality is like, and I don't think any of us will until we actually are born and raised and go back to living to this lifestyle. Until you're born in it and you live it every day of your life. But see, now it's easy for us to say, no, I don't want to live out here, because you know the comforts and because you know of how you were raised in this modern society. But if you were born out here and this is all you knew, you would be happy. Your happiness is relative. You would be happy out here. You would be strong. You would be physically fit and active as long as you didn't have any, disabilities or anything like that. Like I said in the very beginning, how many obese Aboriginal people do you see? Not very often, right? Because they're living off the land. Hunt and forage, they burn the calories, they're staying fit. They have all this knowledge and the ability to craft with your tools. And today we're crafting to make money. And what does that money do for us? Again, you're still dependent upon people to get you the food and the clothing to make it. And those people are usually making minimum wage if they live in the United States. Where's your food? Where's your clothing come from? Where does your cell phone come from? Where does your monitor come from? Where does all this stuff come from? Who are the people outside the United States? You see a tag that says made in China, made in Taiwan, manufactured in here, blah, blah, blah. Again, you're part of this global economy, this modern civilization, and you're supporting and enabling everyone from your next door neighbor to the KKK into ISIS. That's not really my point to come out here and make a political statement like that, but that is the reality of it. But this is where we belong. I believe it. And it's not going to change how I make my videos. I'm going to still do what I do, because that's what I need to do. That's what makes me happy in this civilized society where I'm not overall, where I'm not completely happy overall, because I'm not doing what I think my body should be doing as a human being. And it's not like, you know, I want to come out here and I leave the wife and kid. That's not that at all. If I had the knowledge and I knew we could come out here and survive, yes. No, I'm not going to leave them. I don't want to. I wouldn't live out here. I wouldn't survive out here. But this is where we belong. And I feel really strongly about that. That's the statement that I wanted to make with this one video. This one little video that's just one aspect, one little mindset of mine. And if you feel the same way, then hopefully we can do little things that get us back in touch with who we are as human beings. Come out here as often as we can. Try to live minimalist life. If you have kids, co-sleep. You know, family unit, being social, very important. I'm not an anti-social person. Society has made me a little bit of a misanthropist and a little bit antisocial. Just because of society and civilization, how it is. I'm not like some person that's been hurt so bad that I want to come out here and die. It's not it at all. So a lot of the, you know, human behavior, a lot of the human behavior, a lot of the bullying, a lot of that stuff, and organized religion, a lot of that's a product of society and civilization, and the stressors. You know, the dad that yells at the kids because of all the pressures put on to the dad to be some kind of stereotypical male, doesn't show feelings, and all these pressure to work, and is overworked, and all that, and the constant pressure causes depression, and then all that anger comes home, and, you know, deals with it somehow, and accidentally, you know, beats their kid. They're never meant to be that way, but that's what society does to people. So this civilization is a cancer or a parasite or a disease, however you want to call or look at it. It's an unhealthy way of living. And we need to return out here. If there's any hope or future of us reclaiming our humanity and getting back to basics. And that's what I believe. But I don't know how to do that. I can't do that. I wasn't taught that. I was taught how to worship a god and then how to math, how to English, so that I could be a productive member of society, like I said in the beginning. So that I could support people and their jobs and their businesses. That's not supporting society. We're supporting the wealthy. That's what this is. So, I think I've spoken enough, and there's probably a lot more to speak about, different pros and cons, but I think I've given you an idea that I have, you know, some of the knowledge and awareness of the pros and cons, and there's a lot more to it than just making a switch and coming living out here. If you can do it, all the power to you. But you can't just take a whole city, New York City or Philadelphia, and dump everyone out here and expect them to live, survive. Somehow we now have to make a gradual change to come living out here. saying goodbye to government, saying goodbye to economy or capitalism, you know, and returning to who we are as human beings and reclaiming our humanity, reclaiming power, being empowered over our own decisions and what we eat, and teaching our children and being more of a community, taking care of our elders and not just throwing them into a nursing home. And paying people that take care, the people, that's another tragic aspect, disgraceful aspect of civilization, is how caregivers are paid, or some of the, you know, paid, do a, such a stressful and a wonderful job for people, but are paid little amount. How does that make any sense? There's so many aspects to talk about, and I mean, this video could be like 10 hours long, or it could be like an hour long mini series, you know, talking about every angle and all this. But I want to come out here, make this statement, back it up a little bit, show it from different angles, you know, and hopefully I can reach one person out there who feels strongly the same and kind of like, yeah, we're all stuck in this boat. This is the truth living out here. And that's what I believe. So that's it. I'm going to return to my little civilized house and put this video together. And then hopefully I'll, you know, my wife still has her job, still be able to pay the mortgage, so we can still get food and pay everybody all these bills and things that keep me, it's like on a life support system. It's what it is. It's like I'm a host for a parasite. I have all these tubes coming into me to keep me alive. Electric bill. I have the electric company. I have the cellular company. I have the cable company. You start to unplug them, right? And you start to lose your life support. It's like unplugging from the matrix. So. All right. Thanks very much for listening. However long you listen to, I appreciate it. And I just wish you all my best as, you know, as we try to make sense of this world, which doesn't make a lot of sense and has a lot of contradictory, a lot of inherent, a lot of hypocrisy and contradictions built in to this modern civilization. And a lot of things that we aren't aware of that go on that we probably shouldn't be supporting. And then we need to get back to basics. All right. Take care of yourself. Wish you all my best, and see you around. Bye-bye.